It is my pleasure to introduce our presenter today, Verne Williams. And Verne Williams is the owner of the B&W Gardening Consulting and Design.
Thank you very much. We are one of the hardest areas in the world to garden in. With our altitude, our proximity to the mountains, and the real killer, our Chinooks. Siberia has better growing conditions than we do. So the fact that we garden and we can get these beautiful gardens at all must mean that we're really good. What is one of the most important things about growing a garden is plants need light. Full sun is 6+ hours. Now, none of this has to be consecutive. It can be 2 hours in the morning and 4 hours in the afternoon. It can be broken up. As long as throughout the day, the amount of light it receives is 6+ hours. We consider that full sun. The photo you're looking at now, this would be considered deep shade in a forest floor. You can see not a lot growing in there. Now, I want to talk about the sun. Morning sun versus afternoon sun. We generally call the morning sun the gentle sun. That's the east sun. It comes up in the morning. It's soft. It's sweet. You know, lovely sun. Then we go into the afternoon where the sun is coming out of the west. The sun gets very harsh. It's almost like it's burning. It's a hard sun. We can have full sun, but even which direction it's coming from can mean quite a bit. If you are growing large leaf greens, such as your kale, your spinach, or your lettuce, you want them to have that morning sun. You want the gentle sun. Also, you want them to go out of sun about anywhere between 1 and 2 o'clock. You don't want them in that harsh afternoon sun at all because it's just too hard on them, right? You get them out in full sun and bang, they're gone to seed right away. Why that's a bad thing is once your large leaf veggies go to seed, their leaves turn into shoe leather. Now, I've got an example here of a garden. This is full sun and it faces west. It's up here in the northeast. You can see I've got lots of beautiful plants. They grow very well here. I've got artemisia. I've got some grasses. I've got some irises. I've got some chives. All of these do very well in that hot, hot afternoon west sun, and they're also generally known to be a little on the drought tolerant side. Now, this is a full sun east face garden. Got some more of our little more tender plants in here, but again, you can see we've got lots of plants. Things grow very well. Now, dappled light is the light, as I said, that comes through the trees. I'm going to call them tiger lilies. They're yellow tiger lilies, not orange ones, but yellow ones. They love dappled light. They love to be planted around trees, and they do very well. Someone else who also loves dappled light is hydrangeas. Now, a clue to growing hydrangea, it's right in their name, hydra. They like water. They want to be moist. So in a more shaded area, they have a tendency to be in a more moist situation. Now, if I go into part shade, remember this is 4 hours. There are so many plants that love this kind of conditions. This is actually my back garden. I have quite a bit of a shade area and I just love to grow. I mean, I've got hostas and I've got ferns and I got ajuga and I got Jacob's ladder. I've got Solomon's seal. The list really goes on. There's so many things that really do love to grow in part shade. When I go into shade, now this is only 1+ hour of light. There's still a large number of plants that wish to grow. Again, you're in my backyard. What you see here is this is lungwort with the large leaf with the spots on it. I love those silver spots. Silver spots also sparkle at night, folks. Love the silver. And then planted around it as a ground cover, this is sweet woodruff. I just love this little flower. It's got a little, almost a rubber tree, little leaf, little white flowers, goes in around as a ground cover. And beside that, you can see I've got a big ostrich fern. The ostrich ferns do very well for us here. They're actually a Manitoba native, but they do very well in a shade garden. Also here to my right, this is called rocket ligularia. And it's just absolutely one of my favorite plants. They are growing on the north side of my house. They only get about 3/4 of an hour of light in the early morning, about 7:30 to about 8, maybe a little later sometime in high summer. And then a little bit of light in the evening comes over my neighbor's fence, was when I took this photo. I love the big yellow spikes. They're bright, they're cheery, but bees absolutely adore Ligularia. I walk by, it's just a buzz. They just love it. And they do very well with very little light. The only key is they do like to keep fairly moist. Now, what else do our plants need? Well, they need moisture. They need water. The best place to get rainwater is from the sky. It's pH neutral. It's non-chlorinated, untreated with any chemicals. It's fresh and it's free. When it falls from the sky, it is free. Now, rain barrels are a wonderful way to capture that moisture, to keep it, and you can run it out into your garden. You can be as simple as just having a barrel, or you can get a little more high tech as we see on the right, but you can really trap a lot of water off of your roof. So I found this little graph here is 1 inch of water on a 2000 square foot roof. It's 1250 gallons of water. That's a lot of water. Now, if you don't want to go through the trouble of setting up rain barrels and capturing that way, the very best place to capture water and to hold it is in your soil. On the left, this is a picture of my girlfriend's rain garden up in the northeast here. It's going in. It's in the process of being put in. On our right, we see a wider path of gravel coming around. We got some big stones in there to slow down the water. That's actually accommodating two downspouts, her neighbor and herself. There was a big problem with ice on the sidewalk in the winter for both the neighbors, so they decided to get together and build this rain garden. So that is two downspouts. And then the smaller little strip of gravel you see on to my left, that is actually accommodating a sump pump. On my right, we see another rain garden. You will notice right down the middle in the back, you can see an eaves trough, that white eaves trough, the elbow coming down. And what it does, it goes on to a little gravel pathway. You can just make out some of those white stones, and it brings it down into this wonderful garden bed. It flows through the bed. The plants take up the soil. They've got mulch in there. The wood takes up the soil. So they're capturing this water and they're holding it on the land. Now you're probably wondering why I'm going to talk about soil, and I'm showing you a lovely picture of a mountain. This lovely range of limestone mountains we have here to the west is the source of our soil. What it does is it breaks down. It starts out as a boulder, and then erosion works on it, gets it down to gravel size. A little bit of more erosion works on it. It gets it down to the size of a grain of sand. Then some more erosion, silt. Some more erosion, clay. We have alkaline soil because our soil was created by limestone mountains. If you wish to change the pH of the soil, good luck. You're battling nature. You'll rarely win. It's always better to go with nature than against her. When you have a look at your soil, you probably don't realize that air pockets are very important. Roots need to breathe. So we need to think about, you know, we don't want heavily compacted soil because there's no air and our roots can't breathe. We also want to have moisture captured in there. And then they give about 5% organics. This is an overall average. And then we see 45% is considered the mineral. Now that's what I want to focus on right now is the mineral aspect of it. If you want to know how your soil is on your property, you can do some tests. Now you can get the very complicated soil triangle that I'm working out myself what exactly how it works. The easiest way to go though is to do the mason jar test. Your soil is made up of sand, silt, and clay. That's the mineral side of it. That's its makeup. It does have an organic element, but again, that goes to top. Get a mason jar, fill it about half full of soil from your garden. Then go and fill it about 3/4 full of water. Put just a little drop of laundry or dish soap in there, and then shake it really hard, set it on the shelf, and let it settle out for 24 hours. It will settle into its appropriate size. So sand, being the biggest grain, is going to land on the bottom. This is going to tell you right away, have I got really sandy soil? Have I got really silty soil? Have I got really, you know, a lot of clay? You can see your layers. It will tell you immediately what the composition of your soil is. Now, a lot of us do in Calgary fight with clay soil. We have very heavy clay soil. Clay holds the most nutrients out of all the soil. But what you want to do is you want to get more organic into the clay so it can't compact and compress. Do not add sand. Good soil health is good plant health. If you've got good, healthy soil, then all your micro and macro organisms are in there. They're having a great time. They're feeding. You know, they're making that a very healthy place to be. Now, one of the fungi that you probably have heard about, because it's written on the side of so many bags of plant soil, is mycorrhiza. Why do we want it? It forms a symbiotic relationship with our plant roots. It is able to spread our root system out. You can see on this photo here, all that white around that plant's roots, that's mycorrhiza. And what it does is extends that plant's ability to take up moisture, take up nutrients, take up minerals. It extends that all out so they can do more. And all it asks for in return is a little bit of chlorophyll. I always love this quote because I think it sums up everything. It's better to plant a 50-cent plant in a $5 hole than a $5 plant in a 50-cent hole, because your soil is everything. That's where your plant is going to live. Most of us have grown up hearing that loam is the perfect soil combination. If I'm growing a herbaceous border, if I'm growing my roses, that's perfect. However, it's not perfect for everything. This is a vetch. It's a native plant. It's quite pretty. Look at the soil that's growing in. It's very happy, very healthy. It's growing in absolute disastrous soil. But that's what it wants. So know what you're growing and what it wants for soil. This is where your plant tags are so important. Read your plant tags. It will tell you. You can see here I've got a Veronica, and it tells me it wants moist, well-drained soil. So, you know, moist does not mean wet. Remember that roots do need to have air, but it does mean that it's slightly damp to touch. This is where you want to have a lot of organics in your soil because they hold the moisture, right? And also know what it means. If your tag says that a plant is drought tolerant, they generally are after you get it established. Also, be very wary when you see ground cover. You really want to know how large or how aggressive this plant can be, because some ground covers can really turn into a nightmare on you. They just kind of take over and they start shoving things out. So you really want to know. Silver King and Silver Queen Artemisia comes to mind. They're beautiful silver plants, but Lord, they can take over so fast, and you're out there weeding your plant out. What are you going to need for tools? These are my absolute musts. I need a spade, a fork, hand trowel, and a pair of clippers. It's very important that you decide what to grow, because that's going to tell you what you're going to need for soil and light. If you want to grow vegetables, you really should learn about three crop rotation. Vegetables are quite particular about the soil they're grown in. One likes this, one likes that. We have high feeding plants like garlic and onions. We've got medium feeding plants like squash, or, you know, low feeders like potatoes. If I put squash in a really, really rich garden bed, it's going to do great. I'm going to have leaves galore. I probably won't have any squash, but I'll have leaves galore, because it's gonna just grow leaves like crazy. So you wanna make sure you have the right soil for the right plant, and you keep wanting to move these plants around. It helps cut down on pests, works your soil around. A really good book for this, it is Vegetable Gardening for Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba by Laura Peters. Now, I just want to take a moment and tell you a little bit quickly about the Calgary Horticultural Society. I have been a member for a very long time, and I do instructing for them. We are also with the City of Calgary doing a design class. If you have got a new garden or if you're rejuvenating an old garden, I do urge you to come down to the plant swap. For every plant you bring in, you will receive a chit so that you can take a plant. So I really do urge you to check out the Calgary Hort Society. We're a fun group of people and we really like plants.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much for your recommendation, Verne. And everyone, again, thanks for joining us this evening. Have a wonderful weekend. Good night now.